Good morning. Billy, please read the problem, and Bo, please translate.
Flippin' physics.
Two spheres attached to a horizontal support are rotating with a constant angular velocity. Determine the angular velocity.
Angular velocity equals question mark.
As shown in the figure, L equals 9.7 centimeters, X equals 3.4 centimeters, and theta equals 43 degrees.
We need to convert the lengths to meters, so multiply by 1 meter over 100 centimeters to get L equals 0.097 meters, X equals 0.034 meters, and theta equals 43 degrees.
Mr. P, the title of this lecture is Conical Pendulum Demonstration and Problem. How is this a conical pendulum? Sure, Bobby. A conical pendulum is similar to an ordinary pendulum. However, the pendulum does not swing back and forth. Instead, it swings in a circle. Usually, physics problems have just one pendulum bob. However, the reality is that it is easier to have two pendulum bobs to keep the center of mass of the system constant. You can see if you visually extend the strings upward, they make a cone, hence conical pendulum. Bobby, please begin solving the problem.
Well, let's draw a free body diagram on one of the two spheres. Let's draw it on the sphere on the right. The force of gravity is down, and the force of tension is directed along the string, and we need to break forces into components.
This looks just like the free body diagram when we solved for the force normal acting on the car going up the hill. So just like for that problem, let's break the force of gravity into its components in the parallel and perpendicular directions.
Actually, while the free body diagram looks similar, the circle through which the object is moving here is different. The circle for the car going up the hill was along the hill and was a vertically oriented circle. The circle these spheres are traveling through is actually in a horizontal plane. That means the indirection for the spheres is actually horizontal, which means we need to break the force of tension into its components in the y direction and the indirection.
You have to be careful to always identify the circle through which the object is moving, and therefore which direction the in direction is. In this problem, the spheres are moving in a horizontal plane, and therefore the in direction is in that horizontal plane. So for the sphere on the right at this moment, the in direction is to the left. Bo, please work on it from here.
Sure. We need to draw the component vector diagram for the force of tension. We know sine theta equals opposite over hypotenuse, which equals force of tension in the in direction over force of tension. Therefore, the force of tension in the in direction equals force of tension times sine theta.
Bo, how do you know the theta you are using is the same 43 degree angle shown in the figure?
Because they are alternate interior angles, and alternate interior angles are equal when the two lines being crossed are parallel.
Very nice. Please keep going.
We know cosine theta equals adjacent over hypotenuse, which equals force of tension y over force of tension. Therefore, the force of tension in the y direction equals force of tension times cosine theta. We don't know the force of tension, however, we do not have a numbers dependency, so we can just leave those as equations.
Billy, please continue.
Okay, sum the forces in the y direction. Force of tension in the y direction minus force of gravity equals mass times acceleration in the y direction. We can substitute in equations to get force of tension times cosine theta minus mass times acceleration due to gravity equals, well, the acceleration in the y direction of the sphere is zero. Add mass times acceleration due to gravity to the other side. I have a feeling we should solve for the force of tension because we do not know it. So force of tension equals mass times acceleration due to gravity divided by cosine theta. Put that in our equation holster and sum the forces in the in direction. That equals force of tension in the in direction, which equals mass times centripetal acceleration. Substituting in equations gives us force of tension times sine theta equals mass times radius times angular velocity squared. Substitute in the equation from our equation holster and
everybody brought mass to the party.
Everybody brought maths.
And sine theta divided by cosine theta equals tangent theta. Billy?
Divide both sides by the radius and take the square root to get angular velocity equals the square root of the acceleration due to gravity times tangent theta, all divided by radius. And now we can just plug in numbers and we will be done.
Right, but what does the radius equal?
The radius equals L, the length of the string.
No, it is L plus X.
Actually, no, it is the component of L in the in direction plus X.
We need to find the component of L in the in direction.
That is correct. Bobby, could you please?
Start by drawing the vector diagram of L and its components in the Y and in directions.
We already drew the component vector diagram. We do not need to do it again.
Actually, no, Bo. We drew the component vector diagram for the force of tension. Even though the component vector diagram for the force of tension and the one for the length vector look similar, we have to be careful to consider the length vector and the force vectors separately. Bobby, go ahead, please.
Okay, sine of theta equals opposite over hypotenuse, which equals L in the in direction over L. Therefore, L in the in direction equals L times sine theta, and the radius equals L times sine theta plus X. We can plug that equation for radius back into the equation we got for the angular velocity and substitute in numbers. We get the square root of 9.81 times the tangent of 43 degrees divided by the quantity 0.097 times the sine of 43 degrees plus 0.034, and that equals 9.55716, or 9.6 radians per second with two significant digits.
We need to be smarter than our calculator.
We took the square root, so we need to decide if the angular velocity is positive or negative.
We get to use the right-hand rule.
Find your right hand!
Limber up, because I am not too cool for the right-hand rule.
Okay, so take the fingers of your right hand and curl them in the direction the spheres are rotating, and we get the angular velocity is down, which is negative.
The angular displacement is negative, too.
I get the direction is up.
That's your left hand. Jinx, you owe me a soda.
Right.
That's great. Now let's check our answer. We can measure the angular velocity of the spheres using the video. All we need is the time for one full revolution, which is 0.66 seconds. The measured angular velocity equals angular displacement over change in time, which for one full revolution is negative 2 pi radians, negative because of the right-hand rule, over 0.66 seconds, which works out to be negative 9.51998 radians per second, which is pretty close to what we predicted with our known values. However, I would like to know how far our prediction is from our measured value. Using the relative error equation with our measured value as the observed value and our predicted value as the accepted value, we get a negative 0.39 percentage difference between what we predicted and what we observed. Which means we get to say, the physics works, 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 the physics works. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you.